following interview was conducted with Mary Holtman for the Purdue University Library Oral History Program. It took place on Monday, April the 2nd, 2007, at her home in West Lafayette. The interviewer is Katherine Markee, the Oral History Librarian. Welcome. Tell us a little bit about where you were born and your parents.
I was born in Indianapolis, and my father was a plumber, and my mother had worked in the grocery store, in her dad's grocery store, and she was going to be a dressmaker. And so when they were married, then he had already erected a house for them on land that was owned by his father, and had been, you know, plotted, you know, for homes. And so she was going into a really nice little home. And I was the fourth child born in that home. But when the war started, my aunt couldn't find, you know, people to work for her. And he couldn't get parts to do plumbing. You know, everything was for the war effort. So then Grandpa passes away, and in 17, Grandma passes away. And so they just packed up and came back to Lafayette and moved into the old home on 11th and Cincinnati. So it was tragic for both of them because they had such a good start. And being independent, he was not working for anyone, he was working for himself and had a partner. And to come back to Lafayette and move into the home that my mother was born in, and it was an old house then, and there were eight children in her family, in the brothers and sisters. And, well, anyway, my grandfather bought that from the people who had the church at the corner of the 11th and Elizabeth Street, and they had eight children. And then we end up, I'm one of eight children. And a stair to the second floor was of soft wood. And you know, that many kids up and down stairs, it was just, you had to watch yourself. But it was a blessing to be able to grow up there. It was in walking distance of the store. It was in walking distance of grade school. And I went to Washington grade school for kindergarten, St. James, first grade. And everybody knew everybody in the neighborhood. So you didn't, you could go independently and not get lost because everybody knew us. It was just kind of a quaint time
in your life.
In 18.
What year were you born? What was your date of birth? What, when were you born?
24th of 1918. And they had incorporated the grocery store of the grandparents. And so all the children had shares. So when Grandpa died, Grandma became the CEO. And then the oldest boy, store. And so, just eventually, everybody found their niche of what they wanted to do. And my aunt ended up then managing the store and eventually buying out all the brothers who wanted to do big things. And one worked in a company, the Ofterheides, had a loan company. And he went to Indianapolis to work. And Uncle Heine started Sherman and Lang in 1928. And Uncle Will, the oldest, bought a franchise in Milwaukee with the Buick Agency. And my aunt, the oldest, wanted to be a milliner. So she worked for a milliner on just right off of 9th Street, on Main Street. And my mother was becoming with a woman in a neighborhood, pretty skilled with her interest. And having five girls, she had a lot of practice. And then Aunt Clara, she went to Fort Wayne to Lutheran Hospital and worked during the war. And Aunt Em, the youngest, had finished her master's degree at Purdue in 1915 and was a life member. And that was her oath. And she was going to be teaching German. That's what she was going to do. Well, the war, she couldn't teach German, so she switched to French and taught French in the southern part of the state. Everybody had just exactly, you know, what they wanted to do.
Now, did you go to grade, you went to grade school, or did you go to high school here?
I went to Jefferson. And Jefferson High School was just wonderful. A lot of my aunt's contemporaries were teaching in that
school. At the time that you were there?
Yes. So everybody knew us. And they all traded at my aunt's store. So we got to know them as customers. And you know, I just can remember so much about all those teachers. The one lived on Brown Street at 12th Street, in a great big old house, and you didn't ever hear of kids running away to get married, but she did. And she married a man who worked with lumber and built this gorgeous house. And when I was taking her course in economics, I got really well acquainted with her. And she was so vivacious, into sports, you know, watching sports and everything. And when she wanted to go to something, I would sit with her mother. And then she decided one time she'd go to Lake Banff and Lake Louise, you know, Banff and Lake Louise. So I, you know, stayed overnight. had to put drops in the mother's ears and do all those things. And I got to live in that gorgeous, beautiful house. And she would call me to wake me up, you know, for breakfast. And I always had a delicious breakfast. And she made her cherry jam, you know, by putting it out on the backyard, in the backyard, you know. So that was good. And
then I understand you told me you graduated from Purdue.
Yes.
Had you decided to go somewhere else, or you wanted to go to Purdue?
Always wanted to go to Purdue.
Not IU.
Well, I knew everybody. And home economics at that time was with laboratory and all of that sort of thing. So we got to even help sometimes in doing some work in the cafeteria.
What was your major in? Did you have a specialty in home economics?
I was just a journalist.
And did you live at home and go to school, or did you live in a dorm on campus?
But I joined a sorority.
Oh, uh-huh.
And so I could stay at the sorority overnight,
uh-huh.
Or during the day if I wanted to go over to the house. We had what they call the town girl's room, so we could make ourselves comfortable.
What sorority did you join?
Chi Omega. And two of the women that I had in class at Jefferson High School were Kyles. So I ended up, you know, and I didn't think I was going to get to go because I had a rush from all of the sororities. And so I went through rush, and I didn't know whether I'd be chosen or not. But I was invited by three of them, so I had a choice. And, with those two former teachers, and one was a home economics teacher, and the other one was a math teacher, I felt really very comfortable to choose Chi Omega. And, with my tuition being $50 a semester at Purdue, and my sorority was $50 a semester, and I always had a dinner with the group on Monday night. That's when the chapter met, and so I had my father was just a great guy, and my mother was a great manager. But one Sunday, while we were still at the table after our meal, which is always the elaborate meal of the week.
This is at home, in your house?
At address in Lebanon, Cincinnati. And my uncle came over from Indianapolis and stopped in. And so now we're talking about what are you kids doing? And Mom said, well, Mary has to decide what she's going to do with sorority. And I said, I'm going to go there. And he said, well, he paid my sorority, you know. So I got my money from the sorority. But then he said, you know, if you're initiated, and Esther, who was 2 years older, she ought to go too. So we said, I'll take care of both of you for that. So Esther and I then pledged. And then when my two sisters, Carolyn and Doris, they also joined. So we have a real close relationship with a lot of professors who were at Purdue, and the dean of Mariel Matthews, the first time I met her, she says, "How's your Aunt Em?" And I thought, you know, how does she know Aunt Em? Well, see, they were contemporaries. And then Felina Palmer, who was in clothing, she lived up in Highland Park. She was there. The people in the foods, they were also Chi Omegas. You know, it just
got weird.
It was just perfect. And it was my senior year when I met Dr. Lillian Gilbert.
And how did you happen to meet her?
She spoke to our class in housing that was taught by Margaret Beeman. And Margaret Beeman, it was just an exciting program because we had things that we had to do outside the class. And I had such a neat notebook that I put together. And I just wrote all the time she was talking. So when I got finished with the course, I would go out and take the trolley, which was a nickel, and get home. And the first thing I did was to type up all of my notes. And then I had magazine after magazine that I clipped to show Dutch Colonial or, you know, whatever. And the interesting thing about that, when we heard Lillian Gilbert talk, and that was on time management and so forth. Well, I got into that big time because when my brother went through his engineering program, mechanical engineering, he did a lot of time and motion. And he would line us kids up at the end of a meal, and we would try different ways of clearing that table and stacking and getting things out, you know, for the washing of the dishes. And then he would time us, you know. It was always fun because after the work was done, my mother just loved to play ping pong, just like we did. And our table was so wide. It was the table that was in my father's home in Indianapolis. That finally ended up in our, and we could sit 14 people at that table. So we could attach the net and everything. And we had to have certain kind of rules because that table, you know, had those sleeves or slats, and not what do I want to say?
The inserts that you put on the table. Right?
Yeah, so to stretch that out. But we just loved to play. And we'd always have to play singles. We couldn't play doubles.
What was the campus like when you were here?
Oh, it quaint.
A lot small. What years were you, when did you get your degree?
I got my degree in 40.
Okay. Right, but then did you go on
I started to teach school.
Here in town?
Oh, no, I taught in two rural schools. One was up in Marshall County, and again, a quaint situation. It was right on the bend of the Tippecanoe River, and that's where it's, you know, you can throw things across the, and I lived with this, in this farmhouse with two other teachers. And the man had these two big Belgian sorrel horses that, you know, he plowed with and that sort of thing. And I had to, you know, just kind of refinish everything in the laboratories. So I was scraping and painting, and the kids were helping me to bring it up to a neatness and cheerful and all that kind of stuff. Screen doors on the labs so the flies didn't get in and that sort of thing. But when living in that farmhouse and seeing how, I had never seen how women would cook on a stove range like that, you know. They had their place for water and this, that, and the other. And Mr. Guy was, and his wife would have breakfast with the three of us. And he was always talking about the Kentucky Derby and all those beautiful horses and everything. And when May came, that first year that I taught there, he had talked about it so much. And I said, Mr. Guy, would you like to go to the Kentucky Derby tomorrow? You know what I'm saying? And he said, Sari, can I go with the girls to the Derby? And she said, yes. And so she packed us a lunch that afternoon. I got my car serviced and school was out. We headed for the Kentucky Derby. And we planned, the three of us girls had a place to stay, and we found a place for him to stay. So Friday night then, as soon as we got in, we were all ready to take a nap. And then early the next morning, we'd get up. And of course, we couldn't buy our tickets ahead of time, so we went into the inn circle inside, you know. And he bought us each a gardenia. And we couldn't see the race at all, we just heard it. And so after the race was over, Eddie R. Carroll had won the race with his horse. And he was so happy. And so then we headed for home. And on the way, I had the nerve to ask, I said, how old are you, Mr. Guy? He said, I'm 80. It's my birthday. I said, you gotta be kidding. Boy, did I straighten up and fly right, driving that car back, that nothing would happen to him. I thought he might have a stroke because it was so exciting. And he was so excited. And he talks all the time, you know. But then, shortly after we got back, I had a call from my brother, and he was living up in Evanston. And he wondered how I was getting along, you know, with the teaching and that sort of thing. And I said, well, I'm not having any problems. The Morehouse twins, who lived out on 52, were teaching up in Marshall County also. So when I was stuck on anything, all I had to do was get in touch with them, and they kind of mentored me because both were teaching. And but I said, I had taken Mr. Guy, you know, to the race. Well, this was one of those phones that everybody could listen in on. So from then on, everybody knew that I, because he had told everybody that these school moms had taken him to the race. It's, you know,
an unforgettable experience. Huh? An unforgettable experience.
Oh, yeah. It was just great. Then I taught a second year. And in that second year, they didn't have anyone to teach biology. So they added that to me. I was already teaching all the home ec and running the junior class and helping them get a program for the seniors so that we could go on a trip. The young man with the in the biology class was, he was always up to something. He just wore me out trying to keep his attention and keep him on track. But it wound up at the end, and I was leaving because the tenor teacher trainer, Jeanette Parvis, had an eye on a school in Benton County for me. So I was going to be going the next year for Benton County. But this young man was living with his grandmother. His father was working in Chicago, and his mother was teaching at one of the schools here in Lafayette. He was an unhappy guy, but it turns out that years later, I am visiting my family at Christmas time, and this young man calls, and one of the members of the family said, there's a man here who wants to talk with you. And so I said hello, and he said, hi Mary, this is Bob. And I thought, Bob, who? So I waited until we had a little conversation. That was the kid that I had so much trying to keep control of the class so it wouldn't run away from me. And turns out in our conversation that he had gone to Indiana University, got his degree, and then he went to MIT, and he had to get some more credits before he could go. But he ended up then with a PhD. And he was so excited that he reached me and he said, you know, when he got back to New York, hopefully, there would be some times I could visit him. And then he wanted to introduce me to his friends. And then he was kind of like, do you ever get out of Lafayette? And I said, yes. In fact, I'm going to Chicago. Yeah. Stay. said, if that's the case, where are you staying? I said, I'm staying at the Knickerbocker. It's right across from the Drake Hotel. They said, could I see you then? I said, why, sure. I'd like to have you meet me. So I got into the hotel, and I went to the desk to see if I had any messages. And I was sharing a room with a harvester, home economist, from New York. We were both working the furniture mart that week. And so it was a cold night, a lot of snow. And in fact, it was pretty hard even crossing the street with all of that snow. So I thought, well, it's late, the train was late, I was late. I think he's not going to show up. So I started taking off my earrings and getting myself ready for bed. And I didn't get too far, and the phone rings. And the man at the desk said, there's a young man here who is, if you would come, he'll meet you in the lobby. So I went down. And all the time I'm doing it, I had not seen that young man in all that time. And I thought, his jeans never were long enough. His shirts were always too tight. He was always growing out of everything. So I didn't know what to expect. But that's when the gray flannel suit was very popular. And here I think, as I get off the elevator, I see this tall, handsome guy in this. And I thought, what do I do? Do we go to the bar? Or do we go to the coffee shop? I thought, I think I'm going to go to the coffee shop with him. Because the bar was noisy, and I had no business going to the bar with him, I thought. So we went to the coffee shop, and I ordered a cup of coffee, and he had a cup of coffee. And the first thing he said to me, he said, you know, Mary, every time I've talked with you before, I've been all mixed up. I'm not mixed up anymore. I said, it's pretty obvious to me. You're not mixed up. So then he told me his whole story. He was so excited about sharing this with me. That's why I stayed in teaching. I've had a number of kids that have kept up, you know, with me. So that's
a good example.
A real good example of the patience you have with young minds. And there are a number of students in there that were unhappy during the war and living with grandparents and being dressed with older clothes and not feeling very happy. So old dresses, you know, shoes and so forth. But I put a lot into that. Economics, everything I ever learned I had to work with. But social service, that kind of counseling, and working out problems that were bigger than my 22 years of age at the time. But I had, when you taught home economics then, whatever topic you were studying, whether it was food or clothing or whatever it was, then you had to carry out a whole project. So I would go out to these farm homes and sit around the kitchen table with the parents and check on the project that the child wanted to carry out in the home. And I wanted to be sure that she could carry it out so that she wouldn't come at the end of a semester and say, well, I couldn't do it. Like, that was too much money, or that was this, that, or the other. So these two sisters had a hard time living with each other in this one bedroom. And, you know, the family was upset. So the one wanted to move a bed, it was an iron bed, out of one bedroom and put it in this. It was just a huge walk-in closet. It just fit, you know. And we made a closet out of that with crates that oranges came in. So we, you know, and put a rod between and hung clothes and put shoes and that kind of stuff. Well, that solved their problem. Those two didn't have to sleep in the same room. So the mother sent it to WLS, and it was aired on one of their shows, the solving of this problem. And that was really, boy, I tell you, some of the original thinking of these kids just kept you on your toes. And then transportation to go anyplace. You know, my car, I had to have stamps to drive it. And I had to make trips, you know, to get supplies for classes and things like that. But then, how do we get to Niagara Falls, like the class before got to Niagara Falls? And what we had to arrange is for the train that came through and let them know that we wanted to get on at Tippecanoe, Indiana. And so we all got on and went on to Niagara Falls.
For a field trip?
Huh?
A field trip?
A field trip. And so now we were there just a short time. I think it was early in the morning. I think I don't remember staying overnight in a hotel. But I do remember that seeing the falls. There was an opportunity for it to fly over the falls, and one of the students wanted to do it, and I said, well, I'll go with you on this. And it was Captain Eretz who trained the pilot that flew us over Niagara Falls. Well, that got around in the county too pretty good. But then we slept on the train coming back.
What were some of the other things that you've been, did you do anything to do with Purdue, any projects at all over time, or did you do anything? most of your work stay in the teaching?
My teaching at Purdue was when I was hired by Purdue Research Foundation to work with low-income families up in Lake County.
Well, about what time was this? What year?
1960. And I had just finished 5 years with the National Project in Agricultural Communication at Michigan State. And that was the blessing, because communication is everything when it comes to working with people. My one handicap is I've never liked the idea of writing very much. But interpersonal, whatever else, visualizing, all this, I was good at. So I was interviewed by Dr. Charles Washington, who was head of continuing education. And then I was interviewed by one of his students who was at Purdue Calumet campus. And I took the job. I thought it was just perfect. What I learned about from a sociologist, how to work with community and the like, I was ready to test out all of that in this project. It took a little while for me to get to know the community, maybe 3 months. But when I knew what was available to help me with that project, I just went to the high-rise apartment where I thought we could carry this out. And listening to what was bugging the women, that's exactly what I said, what's bugging? And they said, well, this apartment, living with children, and the elevator that they had to use, or they could walk up the stairs. But the elevator was always being jimmied for one reason or another. It was rough, and they didn't have, this high rise was built on three sides, plot of land, and traffic on all four. They could not get over to the park without someone helping them. And the closest, the park, as you just would cross the street, there were people, older men, you know, in those parks. So you had to go past them and to where the equipment was. And the mothers had to go with them. They didn't have a safe place. So I just started working with them in such a way to let them know that nobody was going to supply them with child care so they could work someplace else. We'll just roll up our sleeves and we'll do it ourselves. And they all pitched in. They just did a fabulous job of working with their children. And to get it going, we met several times, and I decided that I give each one of them a book because the kids were going to sit on their laps. And I knew a book, they could turn the pages and that sort of thing. And then I knew that that wouldn't last very long. So I also had some balloons for the mothers to blow up. And so when they got those balloons up and got them tied and on a string, then the kids were ready to get off their laps. Now we could make a little more progress. And I had a blackboard. I could just take all their ideas, and I put them all down, and I spaced them out, because to talk about goals and what we're going to do, you know, was a little much for them at that point. But we finally got all of their ideas down, and then we could say, well, this has to come first, and then this, and then this. And I said, no, if the children get to running and making too much noise, we'll just ask them to be a little quiet. But if anybody gets to fighting over a balloon and they come to you and want to be cuddled, don't pick them up. Just put your arm around them and pat them on the back. And don't communicate with them. Just let them know. You see how tough things are. But, you know, I didn't want them to disturb us any more than that.